Good morning. Yes, please stand and worship with us.
I count on one thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now. Same God who's never late, he's working all things out, he's working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy.
I'm bad at clapping. I can never direct them. It's great to worship with everybody. It's great to see everybody, whether you're in here or in person or online. I just wanted to say that we may encounter trouble. We may encounter bad times, bad situations, and we might not always know why, or we might be questioning God, saying, why do you let this happen to me? Things like that. Isaiah 41, verse 10 says, do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you, and I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. And it also says, again in Isaiah 43, verse 2, when you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. God's always watching over us, but he allows us to encounter these things to remind us of our need for him, to rely on him for strength and for guidance. And through God, just remember that all things are possible. We've never walked alone, and the battle belongs to him. So please continue to worship with us.
No. victory. When all I see is the mountain, you see a mountain move. And as I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. In every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing.
Battle. Nothing can stand against.
just how much you've done, knowing every victory was your out in us. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can say. Never once did we ever
John 15:5. I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing.
teach us to abide. We thank you for the sacrifice of your Son, Jesus Christ, on the cross, that you sent him to die for us, because he is the way, the truth, and the life. No one goes to the Father except through him. Teach us to abide in him and in you. Father, I pray that you would keep that at the forefront of our minds, that we are never alone as long as we continue to abide in you. In your name we pray. Amen. Please be seated.
Good morning. We continue in Acts 21 today, starting at verse 27 through verse 36. I know that because there's these little blue tabs here that tell me to start here and stop there. When the 7 days were nearly over, some Jews from the province of Asia saw Paul at the temple. They stirred up the crowd and seized him, shouting, "Fellow Israelites, help us. This is the man who teaches everyone everywhere against our people and our law and this place. And besides, he has brought Greeks into the temple and defiled this holy place." They had previously seen Trophimus, the Ephesian, in the city with Paul and assumed that Paul had brought him into the temple. The whole city was aroused, and the people came running from all directions. Seizing Paul, they dragged him from the temple, and immediately the gates were shut. While they were trying to kill him, news reached the commander of the Roman troops that the whole city of Jerusalem was in an uproar. He at once took some officers and soldiers and ran down to the crowd. When the rioters saw the commander and his soldiers, they stopped beating Paul. The commander came up and arrested him and ordered him to be bound with two chains. Then he asked who he was and what he had done. Some in the crowd shouted one thing and some another. And since the commander could not get the truth because of the uproar, he ordered Paul to be taken into the barracks. When Paul reached the steps, the violence of the mob was so great, he had to be carried by the soldiers. The crowd that followed kept shouting, "Get rid of him." Please pray with me. Father, we see your faithfulness as the gospel advances. Sometimes it's hard to see that when those who are against the gospel seem to be winning. And in this case, it seems like the end is there. And yet, your faithfulness comes through and you bring on the militia and the apostle is saved. And how encouraging that is to us to see your faithfulness throughout the scriptures. And encourage us to continue in the advancement of the gospel. Father, we ask today that you give Pastor Vince encouragement and boldness as he gives the message that you've laid on his heart. Work on our hearts too, Holy Spirit, as we listen to this message, because you have something to teach each one of us. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Dave. Church, good morning. I got to tell you guys, I am so excited to be back here. It's awesome to be back and worshiping beside you. I know it's been a while since I've gotten to preach here. So yes, I am ecstatic today. I'm excited about the message that we're diving into. We're continuing in Acts, no surprise there, hitting 21 verses 27 through 36. And really what we're going to see in today's passage is Paul is going to have these really good intentions as he goes back into Jerusalem to really help settle and simmer some of the tension and the hostility that is brewing within the city of Jerusalem. But what's going to end up happening is his good intentions are going to backfire and kind of blow up in his face a little bit. And I'm sure we've all had similar experiences to this before. Has anybody else had a similar experience to that? Or you have good intentions, but then you do it and it blows back up in your face? I remember when I was in, I'm going to say middle school because it's less embarrassing for me, but it could have been early high school. I was helping my mom out one day, and I was taking some chores off of her list to help her get things done around the house. And I remember I was doing the laundry for her, and so I take all the laundry, throw it in the wash machine, dryer, bring it back upstairs in the big basket. And as I'm folding it, my mom, she has perfect timing as she typically does, and she comes walking through the living room right as I'm folding one of her favorite sweaters. And she just looked like astonished, like, a aghast when she saw her sweater, because this very nice pink sweater, she informed me, used to be her very nice white sweater that I just turned pink. And so completely ruined her clothes. I had these good intentions, but it just blew up in my face. That was the first and last time I did the laundry in my mom's house. But I'm sure we've had experiences like this before, right? Maybe you're at your job or in your career and you want to take some of the work off of your boss or off of a coworker. And so you go and take initiative on something you weren't really asked to do. And you end up starting to do it, but something goes wrong and you just cause more work. And now your good intention blows up in your face. I even think about like married couples or spouses. Sometimes when the wife comes home and she just kind of needs to vent a little bit about the workday, what is the guy sitting there thinking? Well, how am I going to fix this? And then the guy goes and he tries to fix the situation even though he wasn't asked to do it, and he does what guys do. He just makes everything messier, and then there causes tension in the relationship even though he had the best of intentions to try to help out. So we all have these experiences where we're trying to do something with the best of intentions, but it just seems to backfire. And that's exactly what's happening here to Paul. So to give us a little bit of a recap from where we've been and where this story is kind of climaxing to today, we need to remember that Paul was in the city of Ephesus for like 3.5 years. He was planting the Gentile church. God was moving in remarkable ways, but he felt called and convicted by the Holy Spirit to come back to the city of Jerusalem. And so he starts making his way back, even though everybody's telling him, do not go to Jerusalem. Paul knows he's going to be persecuted. He knows he's going to suffer, and he knows he is going to be bound and arrested. But he continues to go because that's where God's calling him. Once he gets into Jerusalem, he meets with the Jerusalem elders, and this is last week's passage. So he meets with the elders in Jerusalem of the Christian church there, including James, who's the half-brother of Christ. And Paul and a few of the Gentile believers that are with them are telling these elders about how God is moving among the Gentile people. And it's this really kind of awesome and authentic scene of the Jewish believers and the Gentile believers being led by Paul, just praising and worshiping God together. And all of a sudden, the narrative kind of turns a little bit. You see, James is likely the spokesperson here who is talking to Paul, and he says, listen, Paul, that is awesome that God is moving among the Gentiles. We should be praising God for that. But I got to tell you something. There's some rumors that are spiraling around Jerusalem, and they're all directed towards you, and it's all about you, and they're creating a lot of hostility and tension and anger. And now people are going to hear, Paul, that you're back in the city of Jerusalem, and I know that they are going to be out to kill you. And so James and the elders of the Jerusalem church basically come up with this plan to try to reduce some of the hostility, to try to reduce some of the tension. And the plan is simply this, that Paul is going to participate in what we would call this Nazarite vow. You can read about more in Numbers chapter 6. But it's this vow that falls under the umbrella of the Jewish ceremonial laws, the very laws that the Jews in Jerusalem thought that Paul was telling all of these Jews among the Gentile areas to forsake. And so those were the rumors that were spinning around. You see, people thought that Paul was going out into the Gentile areas, and they thought that Paul was telling the handful of Jews that lived within those Gentile areas to basically forsake the ceremonial laws, to forsake the Jewish customs, to forsake the Jewish tradition. And that angered a lot of the Jews in Jerusalem, because the way they saw it was Paul was telling the Jews to basically go and live as the Gentiles live. And so this angered them greatly. And so in order to try to kill these rumors, Paul was going to engage in one of those ceremonial laws. He was going to engage in the very thing that he was being accused of telling all the other Jews to forsake. And so what he's going to do is he's going to financially support this ceremonial law, this Nazarite vow, for these four men in Jerusalem that have already started it. He's going to go through this ritual cleansing so that he can enter into the temple without defiling it according to the Jewish customs. And he's going to help them with some of their sacrifices. And again, this is Paul's intention to try to reduce the hostility and the anger in Jerusalem. But as we're going to see in the passage today, this entire thing is going to backfire on Paul. And so as we dig through this message, there's really three main points that we're going to lay out. First, we're going to look at how the Jews responded to Paul and how they used the law to beat down and condemn and judge people. Then we're going to talk about how there's great opposition to the gospel message as we see happening within this passage. And lastly, we're going to talk about how as believers in Christ, we continue to live despite the great opposition of the advancement of the gospel. So with all that framed up, you guys ready to dive into this? Yeah? All right, let's do it. Verse 27 says, when the 7 days were nearly over, some of the Jews from the province of Asia saw Paul at the temple. So again, when the 7 days are over, this is referring back to the ritual cleansing. So Paul has to go through this ritual cleansing, and it's not a one-day thing, right? This isn't like he jumps in the bath, hops back out, and now he's ritually cleansed. This is a seven-day process that he has to go through. And so he's nearing the end of those 7 days when there's these Jews from the province of Asia that see Paul at the temple. Now, at this point, there are Jews from all over the world that are coming back to Jerusalem, and they're there to celebrate a holiday. Does anybody remember the holiday that Paul was coming back to celebrate? Pentecost, right? Yeah, he was coming back to celebrate Pentecost, which as believers, we recognize that as the Holy Spirit coming down into the world and planting the church. What the Jews were celebrating was the receiving of the Ten Commandments on Mount Sinai. And so there were Jews from all over the world coming into Jerusalem, including these Jews from the province of Asia. Now, most commentators agree that these Jews from the province of Asia were very specifically from the city of Ephesus. And so these are the Jews that Paul would have been around for the last 3.5 years when he was planting the church in the Gentile city of Ephesus. And so these Jews would have understood and would have heard the message that Paul was proclaiming. He would have heard how he was talking to the Jews within that city. And they would have recognized his face. So Paul was a similar face to them. So they see Paul at the temple, and this is where everything is about to go haywire. So they stirred up the whole crowd and they seized him, shouting, "Fellow Israelites, help us. This is the man who teaches everyone everywhere against our people and our law in this place. And besides, he has brought Greeks into the temple and defiled this holy place. They had previously seen Trophimus, the Ephesian, in the city with Paul and assumed that Paul had brought him into the temple." So they see Paul near the temple, and right away they start yelling out, "Seize that man, stop that man, go and arrest that man." And so we can imagine that there's some Jews within the area that go and grasp Paul, that go and grab his shoulders, that maybe drag him down and push him on the floor. And then the Jews from the province of Asia, they start throwing the charges out against Paul. And there's two main charges that they're accusing Paul of. The first one we kind of talked about already. It's this idea that Paul was going around to these Gentile areas and telling the handful of Jews within those areas to forsake their Jewish customs, to forsake their Jewish culture, and to ideally forsake their Jewish identity. These are the rumors that were being spread around the city of Jerusalem. Now, we know that that's false, and we know that because when Paul was in the city of Corinth, he took a Nazarite vow. He took one of those vows that fall under the ceremonial law. And on top of that, we saw Paul have Timothy, his friend, go and get circumcised before reaching the Jews, another ritual that fell under these ceremonial laws. And so Paul was following through with some of these Jewish customs and some of these Jewish cultures within those cities. But that's not what was getting back to Jerusalem. You see, these Jews were listening to the message that Paul was preaching, and they were misinterpreting what he was trying to say. Paul was going into those areas, and he was telling the Jews that you're no longer obligated to follow those laws in order to earn your salvation. You're no longer obligated to go and earn your grace. You're no longer obligated to go and earn your place in heaven. He's saying you are freed from those laws because Christ has perfectly fulfilled those. You can still use those customs to praise and worship God, but it's not an obligation anymore. But that's not the rumor that was coming back to Jerusalem. They were taking Paul's words, they were twisting him, and now they were accusing him of telling the Jews to forsake their identity. The second charge that's being levied against Paul is that he took a Gentile and brought him into the temple and essentially defiled the temple. So there's multiple courts within the temple of Jerusalem. There's the court of the Gentiles, which obviously Gentiles can go, Romans can go, Jews can go, pretty much anybody can go into the court of the Gentiles. But then there's another court called the court of the women, where only Jewish women could go. And then there was the court of Israel, or the court of the men. And this is only where purified Jewish men could go. And in order to enter into the court of Israel, what you had to do is you had to pass through one of the various entryways as you went into this courtyard. And at every single entryway, there was a sign saying that no Gentiles and no foreigners can go beyond this point without facing the death penalty. And so this is a sign that we have to talk about a little bit to really understand this passage, because there's two big things we have to understand about this. First, they took this rule extremely seriously. Not only the Jews, but also the Romans. So the Romans, who really didn't care about the Jews at all and basically walked on them whenever they could, the Romans even respected this rule. They did not go into the courtyard of Israel. They left that alone. And they respected the fact that they are going to be allowed to kill people if they violate this rule. And that is the only reason why the Jews could ever kill anybody or execute the death sentence. And so what they would do is if anybody violated that law, they would grab that Gentile, that foreigner, drag them out into the streets, and with no due process, with no trial, with no opportunity for that person to speak for themselves, they would brutally murder that person right in the streets. This was a serious rule that the Jews took very seriously. The second thing that we have to understand about this is that this was not a rule or a law that was ordained by God. Right? God did not put this rule in place. This was a man-made rule. In fact, in Numbers 15, God expects the Jews to be a light to the world, to be a light to the Gentiles, to show them how to live in relationship with God, right? To show them how to worship God. And so God expected Gentiles to come into the court of Israel and to offer sacrifices and to offer praises beside the Jews. That's what God intended. But the Jews weren't interested in that. They came up with this rule out of anger and hatred towards the Gentiles to cause more division among the people. They didn't want the Gentiles involved. They wanted to keep that for themselves. And this goes to show that the Jews here did not know who this God was. They knew the rules. They knew the laws. They even made up laws, right? They knew how to go through all the motions, but they didn't know that God had a heart for everybody within this world. And this is what Jesus condemns them for in Matthew 15. He says, these people, these Jews, they honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me, right? They honor me with their lips. They go through all the motions. They know the religion, but they have no idea who I am, right? They don't know me. They don't know their mission. And the reason why they don't know their mission is because they don't know my heart. You see, what the Jews were doing was they were taking the law and they were misusing it and they were abusing the law, not to point people to God, but to judge people and to condemn people and to beat people down just in the way that they're going to do to Paul here. Now, I'll say, it's easy for us to sit here and point our finger at the Jews and say how they had it totally messed up. But as Christians, as people who are filled with the Holy Spirit, we have to understand that we could very easily fall into this same trap, where we become more zealous for the law than we are zealous for demonstrating the character of Christ. And we fall into this trap where we use the law to, instead of pointing people to Christ, we beat people over the head with it, we condemn them, and we judge them. And I'll throw myself out as an example first, right? When I was really an early believer in Christ and I was learning about Scripture and learning about God's commands, I would very easily fall into that trap where I'd get into debates with people, where I'd be discussing the LGBTQ community or abortion or whatever it is. And I would just drive the law of the hammer of the law home, right? I would make my point. I would out-argue them. I'd out-debate them. But what I was doing in the meantime was I was totally distorting the character of Christ. And do you know what happened as a result? I was just pushing those people further away from Christ. I was pushing those people further away from God because I was just swinging the club of the law right over their heads and beating them with it, essentially. This is not what we're called to do. The law is a good and beautiful thing, and we should proclaim the law to people, but it's got to be motivated by love. It's got to be met with grace and with compassion. We can't use it to judge and condemn an already condemned world. Right? That's not what God is calling us to do. That's not what God has called these Jews to do. He has called us to be a light unto the world, to use the law in such a way that we are driving people to Christ, because it's not the law that brings people to God. It's his love that brings people to God. Right? This is what it says in Romans 4. It says it's God's kindness that draws us in. In Psalm 5:7, David says this. He says, but I, by your great love, can come into your house. In reverence, I bow down toward your holy temple. What is David saying here? It's by God's love that he can approach God. It's by God's love that he can worship him. It's by God's love that he can follow in obedience to him. It's not by his law. It's not by his condemnation. It's not by his judgment. It's by his love and his grace and his compassion. I've never heard a testimony in here where somebody was like, you know, Vince, I gave my life to Christ today. I had this Christian come up to me and just beat me over the head with the club of the law, saying how worthless I was, saying every intention I have is wicked, saying all these awful things and how I'm this sinner and everything like that. Conversation ended, and I said, you know what? I'm going to give my life to Christ today. I've never heard a testimony like that. Oftentimes, I hear the testimonies of, you know what? I was convicted of my sin. I heard the standards of God. I know that I'm living this life that is totally messed up, that is filled with all of the sin and all of these evil intentions. But then I heard of the grace of this God who sent his son to come and die for me even while I was still a sinner. That's usually the testimony I hear. The one that is filled with grace. The one that's filled with compassion. The one that is motivated in love. You guys, if we want to bring people to Christ, we can't just drop the law on them without meeting them with grace, without being motivated by love. It's just going to cause more division. It's just going to cause more hatred. And it's just going to distort the very character of Christ. And so we can't be zealous for the law more than we are zealous of representing Christ within our lives. Goes on, it says, the whole city was aroused and the people came running from all directions. Seizing Paul, they dragged him from the temple and immediately the gates were shut. While they were trying to kill him, news reached the commander of the Roman troops that the whole city of Jerusalem was in an uproar. He at once took some officers and soldiers and ran down to the crowd. When the rioters saw the commander and his soldiers, they stopped beating Paul. So Paul is getting basically the snot beat out of him at this point, right? He's getting beat up. These Roman soldiers come in. They break up the fight. But at this point, the entire city was aroused, right? They dragged Paul from the temple. They slammed the court shut. They started beating him on the streets. It was this violent and awful reaction. Jews were coming in from every angle trying to kill Paul. Now, unfortunately for Paul, this is not an uncommon experience for him, right? He's experienced this a few times in his life. I think about Pisidian Antioch, Derbe, Lystra, all these other cities, Philippi, that he went into, and he was ruthlessly beaten for the advancement of the gospel message. Now, this is something that we have to understand, church, is when we live out the gospel message, when we're living out our faith, the devil is going to use the culture and the world and the people around us to try to oppose the very work that God is doing. I think about the city of Ephesus, for example. You guys remember what happened in Ephesus, right? They started out by worshiping this Greek goddess named Artemis, and this goddess was really at the center of the city, and everything revolved around this Greek goddess named Artemis. In fact, their social norms, their cultural norms, their economic norms were all steeped in this goddess. But then what happened when Paul came in? Right, he advanced the gospel message. The Holy Spirit was moving. People were giving their lives to Christ left and right. Massive revival was happening in the city of Ephesus. And what happened is within that city, the social, cultural, and even the economical norms were all completely flipped on their head because of the presence of God, because of the presence of the gospel message. Everything was changed and everything was challenged. And what happened as a result, there was these silversmiths who were no longer able to sell these statues that were made to worship this Greek goddess Artemis. They weren't selling them anymore because everybody had forsaken that goddess and given their lives to Christ. And so their income was impacted. Their jobs were impacted. Their status and their position and their influence was all impacted greatly because of this massive revival that was happening in Ephesus. And they didn't like it. So what do? They start a riot and they try to drive Christianity right out of the city of Ephesus, attacking it as ruthlessly as they can. If we had to put this into kind of a modern context, if we saw what massive revival would look like in America, I think it would flip our culture completely on its head. I mean, can you imagine if massive revival just happened all throughout, you know, every state in America, what it would do to our culture? Hollywood, they'd be left bankrupt, right? All their trash movies that they're coming out, pouring millions of dollars into that now nobody is going to see because they're so convicted in Christ. It would completely turn everything inside and out, right? Those people would be losing all their money, all their influence, right? All the musicians out there that are coming up with all the trash music that they're trying to sell, nobody would come into the arenas anymore, the stadiums. They wouldn't be buying their tickets anymore because, quite frankly, it doesn't feed them spiritually and they want nothing to do with that anymore. So all of your musicians and everything like that, they would be losing everything. All of their power, their status, their fame, all of it would be gone, right? Can you imagine if like the Sunday games, like all of the Sunday sports games were now completely empty? They couldn't fill a stadium by any means whatsoever because all of the churches are completely packed on Sunday mornings. Can you imagine if all the bars that are filled up on Thursday, Fridays, and Saturday nights were now left completely empty and desolate and being turned into places of worship because people just want to praise God, which, by the way, that's the story of this room, right? This used to be a bar turned into a worship center. Can you imagine if that was happening all around the country? The culture would not be so happy. Christians, we'd be thrilled. We'd be excited. But the culture would be fighting back, man. They'd be opposing every single advancement of the gospel. They'd be trying to tear us down because they want to get back to the status quo. They want to get back to chasing all of those worldly things. They want to get back to pursuing the money and the fame and the wealth because, quite frankly, they think that this life is as good as it gets, which that just sounds terrible, by the way, right? They think this is as good as it gets, and so they want all your money. They want to be able to influence you. They want to be able to control you, so they are going to fight to keep you under the control of worldly powers instead of living in the freedom of Christ. They are going to oppose you greatly. Now, even think about this on an individual level. When we start growing rapidly with Christ, the devil's going to try to sink his claws into our skin as deep as he can and prevent that from happening. I mean, I think about my life when I was growing rapidly with Christ. I think about those moments when God was doing a great work. Those were some of the hardest years of my life. And I'm sure I'm not the only one who has a similar story to that. Right? When we are growing with Christ, when God is doing a good work in ourselves individually or out in the community, the devil is going to try to claw us down. And it's going to seem like at moments where everything is going to be spiraling out of control. But that is no reason to forsake the God who is calling us. It's no reason to forsake Jesus. Right? What does Jesus say at the end of Matthew 28? He says, I will be with you always until the end of the age. I'll be with you always. It doesn't matter how hard the world gets. It doesn't matter how many times you stumble. God is going to be with us always. So it's like, who cares how the culture presses back in? Who cares how we're opposed? We're with Christ. We're with him. There's nowhere else we'd rather be. And this is the mindset that Paul had. He's like, yeah, I'm going to go into Jerusalem. This culture is going to try to break me down. This culture is going to beat me. But I don't care because this is where God is calling me, and that's where I'm going to go. Church, as we grow with Christ, we should expect the opposition. But we shouldn't let that sway us from walking faithfully with Christ. So it goes on. The commander came up and arrested him and ordered him to be bound with two chains. Then he asked who he was and what he had done. Some in the crowd shouted one thing and some another, and since the commander could not get at the truth because of the uproar, he ordered that Paul be taken into the barracks. When Paul reached the steps, the violence of the mob was so great he had to be carried by the soldiers. The crowd that followed kept shouting, "Get rid of him." And so Paul was getting ruthlessly beaten, right? They were trying to kill him. They were trying to take his life outside of the temple. Now, all of a sudden, these Roman guards come in, and Rome is all about law and order, right? So they don't like these riots that are taking place. They come in and try to break up the ruthless beating that is taking place. They get Paul up, they lift him up, and then they put him in chains. They arrest him. Now, we got to think back to Palm Sunday's message. What was that, 3-4 weeks ago? I'm asking you guys to think all the way back to Palm Sunday's message. Do we remember what happened on that Palm Sunday message? Right, Paul was making his way to Jerusalem, and he stopped at this house of this guy named Philip. And while he was at Philip's house, he got a visitor. And that visitor, his name was Agabus, and he was a prophet from God that came and delivered a message to Paul. And Agabus came in, he grabbed this traveler's belt, he took it down, not knowing whose it was, he bound his hands, he bound his feet, and he said, whoever's belt this belongs to, this is what's going to happen to you in Jerusalem. You're going to be arrested, you're going to be chained, you're going to be bound. And so I can imagine when Paul was getting that ruthless beating where they were trying to kill him, and Paul, being a former Pharisee, knew exactly what they were trying to do. He knew that they were trying to take his life. I may be speculating here, but I think Paul was probably thinking, what is going on, God? Right? I'm ready to give my life. I'm ready to die for you, but I didn't think this was the way that this was going to turn out. I thought I was going to be arrested first. I didn't think I was going to die right away. Now it seems like, God, all of your plans are spiraling out of control. What is going on? But then as soon as Paul gets arrested, I can imagine he maybe had a smirk on his face, thinking back to the prophecy from Agabus and just being reminded that, oh, wait, God is still in control, right? God's still in control, right? It seemed like life was spiraling out of control. All the plans were being thwarted. But then he goes, he gets saved by this Roman commander of all people. And then he gets arrested. He is reminded God is still in control, even when the storms of life are crashing down on him. This so much reminded me of the story of Job, by the way. Has anybody read that story, that book of Job in the Old Testament? Such a good book. If you haven't read it, go and read it. It's super good. But basically what happened is there's this guy whose name is Job. And Job is this man who's living righteously and blamelessly before God. And he's kind of got it going on from even a possession perspective. But we get a glimpse into kind of this spiritual realm, into this conversation between the devil and God. And the devil basically comes up to God and says, hey, this Job guy that you like so much, you know, this Job guy is living so blamelessly and righteous before you. The only reason why he's doing so, because quite frankly, is he's got so much stuff. And Job really did have a lot. Well, like he was a pretty wealthy guy. I think he had, what, 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 donkey, 500 oxen, tons of crops. He had 7 sons, 3 daughters. He had a wife that he was married to. Like, he kind of had it going on. And so the devil looks at God and he says, the only reason why he's worshiping you is because, quite frankly, he has all these things and life is pretty comfortable for him. And so the devil kind of challenges God. He says, give me authority to take control of all of these things. Give me authority to take all of these things away from Job and he'll curse you to your face. And God's sitting on his throne, probably not dropping an ounce of sweat. He's like, okay, you know what? Go ahead. Go ahead and try it. And so the devil comes, and in a matter of moments, Job's life seems to be spiraling out of control. I mean, he lost everything. All of his crops burned up, gone. All of his livestock stolen or dead, right? He lost everything from that perspective. But then on top of that, all 7 of his sons, all 3 of his daughters, they were in this house and the whole foundation completely collapsed in on them and killed every single one of them. On top of that, he had a wife that basically turned her back to him and said, go ahead and curse God and die. Be done with it. Then on top of that, he got sores from his head all the way down to his feet, these blistering, terrible, painful sores that was this incurable disease from head to his toes. And then on top of that, for 30 chapters, he spent time with 3 of his friends who came to sympathize with him, but instead of sympathizing, they sermonized to him the entire time. They just preached at him the entire time, which is exactly what you want when you're grieving the loss of your 10 kids, isn't it? Right? You just want people to tell you how wrong you are and how you deserved all this and how you must have done something to offend God, right? That's exactly what Job wanted, I'm sure. So for 30 chapters, he's listening to his friends sermonize at him. He's questioning God. He's questioning God's justice. He's questioning God's character. And all of a sudden in chapter 38, things seem to turn a little bit because God responds to Job. And he kind of comes down harsh on Job, but the whole point that God is trying to make is that, Job, even though your life is spiraling out of control, even though it seems like everything is out of control, I want you to know that I'm still in control. And so he kind of stands up to Job and he says, all right, dress yourself like a man and go ahead and answer my questions. He's like, were you there when I laid the foundations of the earth, Job? Were you there when I spoke everything into existence? Were you there when I filled the oceans and I commanded where the waves are going to start and where they're going to end? Were you there when I did that? Are you there when I bring water and snow onto lands that you nor any man has ever been to before because I am caring and in control of every single ecosystem? Right? Were you there, Job? Right? Were you there? Do you know where I store all of my lightning and all of my hail? Do you know where that goes? Then he has Job. He says, go ahead and look up at the sky. All those stars in the sky, I have placed them all exactly where I want them to go, and I know them all by name. And just so you know, astronomers believe that there's like 100 billion stars in our galaxy. And so God knows every single one of those stars by name. And then there's estimated over 200 billion galaxies in our universe. So like that's a lot of stars and God knows them all by name. He tells Job, he says, go ahead and look at Orion's belt. You see those 3 stars up there that are always in a row? Yeah, the reason why they stay together is because that's what I commanded them to do, and they too are under my control. For thousands of years before you were here, Job, and for thousands of years after, that's how they will stay because I am in complete control. And I'm going to go off script here a little bit, but even the eclipse, right? He didn't mention the eclipse, but even the eclipse, right? I mean, we're looking at the eclipse. Actually, I talked to Dave about this, right? We're looking at this eclipse and we're like, oh, what a scientific phenomenon. And yeah, sure it is. But if you're looking at it as just this scientific phenomenon, you are totally missing the point, right? That is God telling us that he is in complete control of everything. I mean, it blows my mind that God made the sun at just the right size, put it at just the right distance from the earth, then put this spinning rock that we call the moon at just the right size, at just the right distance from earth, that we can have a perfect total solar eclipse. And by the way, that happens like every 18 months. Somewhere in the world, somebody's getting a perfect total solar eclipse. And that's just God reminding us those every 18 months. Hey guys, I'm still in control. I know it feels like the world is spiraling out of control, but I've still got it. I've got it handled. And so this is the point that he's trying to make to Job. And at the end of the story, Job gets restored pretty much everything, right? I mean, his crops are restored, his land is restored, his animals are restored, his kids aren't restored, but that's because his kids aren't lost, his kids are in heaven. That's a separate sermon. But he was making the point that I'm still in control. And even before everything was restored, there's kind of this shift in the heart of Job, where he was filled with peace, where he was filled with rest, even though his crops were still burned up, even though his animals were still dead, even though he still had boils and sores from his head all the way down to his feet, even though he was still looking at the 10 gravestones in front of him. He could be filled with peace in the midst of the storm when he kept his eyes fixed on Christ. When he said, you know what? God is still in control. He's still in control. And I don't know where you guys are at today. I don't know every single person's situation or season that you're in right now, but maybe some of you are in that place where it feels like everything is spiraling out of control. Where maybe that crippling anxiety made its way back into your mind, or maybe that weighty depression just continues to weigh you down. Maybe it's that unexpected loss and that final goodbye that you had to say to someone. Maybe it's that diagnosis that came and completely wrecked your plans. God wants us to keep our eyes fixed on him and say, you know what? The circumstances are what they are, and it feels like life is spiraling out of control, but God still got it. He still got it. And when we keep our eyes fixed on what God is doing in the midst of all the storms that brew our way, we can remain at peace and rest in the promises that he has given us. Church, we serve the God of redemption. He redeems bad situations. That's just what he does. That's who he is. Right? Romans 8:28, it says, all things work together for good for those who love God. All things. We don't necessarily know how that's going to look. We don't necessarily understand how it's all going to work out, but we can trust that his ways, they're greater than our ways. His thoughts, they're greater than our thoughts. And those are the promises and the things that we can find our rest and our peace in. So, church, as we conclude this message, these are the three things that I kind of have for us today. Number one, we should be using the law, not to condemn and not to judge people, not to tear people down, but we should be using the law in love to point people to Christ. Number two, we should expect opposition when God is doing a good work in you, when he's doing good work in the community. We should expect that, but that doesn't mean we should run from it. And number three, we should remember that God is in control. Even when the world is pushing back, even when the culture is closing in on us, even when the devil is attacking us, God is still in control. All right, church, I'm out of words, so let's pray. Father, we just thank you for this day. We thank you for this time to worship you, to praise you, to exalt your name. Lord, I ask that you would just bless each and every one of us, that your Holy Spirit, Lord, would convict us in a mighty way. I pray that we'd be convicted to go out and show your love and your compassion and your grace, especially to those people who don't know you. I pray that you would convict us to live within the peace and the rest that you offer us, knowing and being convicted that you are the God of redemption, that you are in control. Despite what we're going through, despite what we're facing, despite the plans that we had or didn't have, whatever it is, that you are in control, you're going to redeem all things, and you're going to use it all for good. Lord, I pray that we'd be convicted. I pray that we'd walk with you faithfully, and I pray that we'd continue to find our rest and peace in you. It's in your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Vince. Please stand and worship with us. The battle's already won. God has the victory. Have a great week. Thank you.